Ladies and gentlemen, it is my very great pleasure and honor to welcome you all to this event tonight, which will lead us exactly into one of the most pressing issues of the digital transformation we are facing, the question of big data. And I'm very honored and I feel very privileged to have those guests of honor with us who will debate and discuss tonight this issue. On the one hand, Professor Sandy Pentland, one of the most iconic academics on this topic, and my colleague David Deißner will introduce him in a minute, and Andrew Keen, who is actually one of the most ardent critics, at least of those big conglomerates who try to earn the money by collecting huge amount of data. So I'm sure that we will have a very lively and I would assume controversial discussion, and I'm very much looking forward to this. The event tonight is part of a series of events which is labeled Digitizing Europe. We had a large summit at the end of last year, and we will now have more smaller events like this one in different European capitals. And this is the first one in Berlin, so we move to Madrid, to London, other cities as well, to make it really a European kind of debate. The Vodafone Institute for Society and Communications, whose director I am, has the task and feels the obligation to study and explore the ethical, the legal, the political and social framework of the digital transformation of the European economy, and is specifically of big data, which will be the main and core topic of our work for this and next year. And I'm extremely grateful that we found terrific partners to do this. On the one hand, the Data Pop Alliance, and the team is among us tonight, and it's a thrilling cooperation, an initiative, an NGO, which is really looking at the societal role big data can play, but they're also looking on the limitations and the, as I said, the framework that is needed to use big data in a responsible way. And on the other hand, for tonight, Berlin Debates is our partner, is also an NGO that has created this kind of format, which is not very used in Germany, as one has to say. Guido Axmann is sitting here, but he made it happen in Berlin, and I'm very much looking forward to this format as well, and I'm very grateful for the cooperation. I'm very sure that there will be a day when also welcome remarks will be the subject of data-driven analysis, and I could imagine that a data analysis of the quality of substance delivered in those kind of welcome remarks might lead to the conclusion that these kind of welcome remarks are totally dispensable. This humbling experience brings me to a quick end. So I wish you, and actually I wish me as well, a very entertaining, a very insightful debate. And I'm now very glad to hand over to my colleague David Deißner, who will facilitate the debate tonight. David, thank you very much. Enjoy the evening.
Yeah, hello. I'm David Deißner. I'm the head of strategy and programs for the Vodafone Institute, and I would also like to welcome you all very warmly on behalf of the Vodafone Institute and the Digitizing Europe Initiative to this very exciting debate on the data revolution and the impact it has and will have on our lives. Ladies and gentlemen, you have all been terribly busy today, busy producing data. Within the last 12 hours, from breakfast until this very moment, all of you have produced a massive amount of data, consciously or unconsciously. Digital breadcrumbs, call records, credit card transactions, GPS location data by using an app, maybe a running app, or by taking a city rental car by DriveNow. And I'm sure you are aware that this data could, in principle, if all, you know, taken together, tell data analysts an enormous amount about who you are as a person, who you interact with, where you live, where you work, what your preferences are, how much you earn even, whether you lead a healthy life or not. One might argue that the data you've produced in a single day reveal more about you and your habits than you know yourself. In every second, more pieces of data travel through the internet today than we stored on the entire internet 20 years ago. The world is facing a socio-technological phenomenon of historical magnitude and significance, the data revolution. So what constitutes a revolution? Here's what most historians agree on: a fundamental change in power or organizational structures that takes place in a relatively short period of time. The disempowerment of old elites and a redistribution of influence and wealth. Looking at the rapid digital disruption of our global economies and labor markets, it seems that most of these criteria apply. And as with any fundamental change, it creates our greatest hopes and fears. Today, now, spoiler alert, even James Bond is at risk of losing his job because of an evil data mining rival in MI6 who wants to get rid of good old 007's manual work. But of course, there isn't only the dark side. Big data drives new exciting forms of business. It adds value to our digital economy. It helps us to allocate resources more efficiently, to save energy, to fight diseases and crime, to save the environment and understand people's behavior, to drive social change. But it might also lead to problematic forms of social profiling, discrimination or exclusion. So the motion for tonight's debate is, will the data revolution improve our lives? Before I introduce our two distinguished speakers, I would like to let you know how you can participate in today's debate. We would like to encourage all of you here in the room, and also those of us watching us via live stream, to comment on the debate and also to ask questions. Then later on during the floor debate, we'll try to integrate that into the discussion. Please use our hashtag DigitizingEU, which you can also find on the program. In addition to that, we also want to hear, of course, your opinion on the topic and invite you to take part in our online survey. Please take your phone if you still have it on you and log on to our digital voting tool called Manymeter. There's an access code which you can find in your program. Here it is as well, 15133. And you can log on, and there you will find actually two questions. One of the two questions is tonight's motion, or the question of tonight's debate. So does the data revolution improve our lives? Options to answer are yes, mainly yes, ambivalent, mainly no, and no. And the second question, which is kind of related to that, is many providers of free internet services gather the user's personal data. I would prefer, dot, 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 first option, to pay for the services and not have my data gathered. Second option, not to pay for the service and permit my data to be gathered. Later on in the course of the discussion, we will look at the results, so you may now have about 30 to 40 minutes to give your vote. Even though you find only two debaters in your program, there will actually be three guests here on the stage tonight. The third one isn't a particularly creative mind, but he's a passionate data collector who is well connected, and he will listen to everything we say or our two debaters say. Don't worry, it's not this guy. Some of you may know him. This is HAL 9000 from Stanley Kubrick's famous movie 2001, A Space Odyssey, a kind of neurotic data-based artificial mind who reads people's lips. Our intelligent little non-human participant is less neurotic. We haven't given him a name yet, but it actually allows us, maybe we can look at it now, how it works. Can we start the system to explain it? Okay, that might take a while, as it's always with... You know, he's not the fastest, as we can see. Okay, here. So this is a map. You can see that. So okay. So the basic idea is that it can recognize speech, and it can also recognize certain concepts and single words. And then this tool allows us to see where, at this very moment, people in the world tweet about that concept or that notion or that word. You will see the kind of density of tweet activity on the map, and on the right side you can actually see what people are tweeting about. On the very top you see a little measuring tool that shows us, you know, what is going on here in the room. It shows us the sound, and on the left side you can see the Twitter feed of Digitizing Europe. So this is, if you want to contribute, you will see your tweet here on the left side. So without any further ado, I would like to now finally introduce our two speakers. Sandy Pentland, Professor Alex Sandy Pentland is Toshiba Professor of Media, Arts and Sciences at MIT and co-founder of the MIT Media Lab. Sandy is one of the most cited computer scientists in the world and certainly one of the most renowned experts on big data and its potential for social and organizational change. He was named by Forbes magazine as one of the world's most powerful data scientists. He's a much sought-after advisor as well to governmental institutions, NGOs, startups, and companies. He co-leads the World Economic Forum on Big Data, and he directs the MIT Media Lab Entrepreneurship Program and the MIT Human Dynamics Program, just to name some of his many positions and activities. In his most recent book, Social Physics: How Good Ideas Spread, The Lesson from a New Science, he investigates the potential of big data to understand the correlation between information flow, so patterns of information exchange, and human behavior. Very excited to probably find out more about that in a minute. So welcome, Sandy. Please join me on the stage. And our second guest for tonight's debate is Andrew Keen. He's an author, an entrepreneur, and probably one of the world's best known and controversial commentators on the digital revolution. He's been referred to as the Antichrist of Silicon Valley, certainly the enfant terrible. He's the author of three internationally acclaimed books, The Cult of the Amateur, Digital Vertigo, and The Internet is Not the Answer. Andrew is executive director of the Silicon Valley Innovation Salon Futurecast, and he is host of the internet chat show Keen On and a columnist for CNN. Andrew, please join me on the stage as well, and I will switch places. Okay, so just to inform you about the format, we will have two opening statements. Each of our debaters will have 15 minutes in the first round. Then we have two rebuttal rounds. The first round, 5 minutes, and the second rebuttal round, 3 minutes. And then we will open the floor debate. And now I would like to ask Sandy to start with his opening statement.
Good. Thank you. Thank you all for coming. So I want to talk a little bit, just to begin with, to define some terms. So data revolution, internet. I want to refer to the internet as all the things that are connected by internet protocol. So that includes all of your phones, all the sensors to that, not just the web browsers that you see. And in referring to that, you're talking about a revolution in communication that has overtaken the world. It's sort of hard to remember. But as late as sort of 2004, 2005, you would see articles about how half the people in the world had never made a phone call. But of course, today, almost all the adults in almost every corner of the world have a phone. So they're connected by the internet to send messages, to get calls. And of course, they generate data about where they are. Phones work by knowing where they are. They put money in it. Those are top-up minutes to make it work. And suddenly, this whole range of things, these people everywhere in the world are visible in a way that they have never been before. So what does that mean? Well, it means several things that are really profound. One is that information flows places that it never flowed before. In that same period of time, the fatality rate for infants has dropped by 50%. 5 million infants a year no longer die. And the only change that you can really see there is that now they're connected. People know more, they can get help faster, they can organize themselves better. If you talk to the International Telecommunications Union, which runs all the telcos and keeps track of these things, the single most effective thing you can do to alleviate poverty anywhere in the world is provide phones, because phones let people organize their lives, find resources, conduct commerce. And in the intervening years since then, we've also discovered that you can do things like you can map poverty by the way people add money to their phones and some of their activity. You can watch the progression of infectious disease by looking at the pattern of usage. You can identify places that are prone to violence. for ethnic violence and peace enforcement and things like that. And as a consequence of these dramatic changes, these are places where we never knew what was happening until all of the people had died. You didn't know there was a crop failure, you didn't know about the plague until they died, maybe you heard about it then. So the Secretary General of the UN calls this the data revolution, because for the first time we have a transparency in the world and an accountability that was unimaginable only 15 years ago. So a year ago he invited myself and several other experts to talk about what could the UN do worldwide to promote sustainability in the world, poverty reduction, better environment, lower violence, and so forth, a thing he called the data revolution. And 3 weeks ago, the 193 member companies of the UN approved using these new tools to hold countries accountable for how they are helping their population, and donor countries like Germany, like the United States, like others, will use this data to direct money to help poor people, suffering people, with greater transparency and accountability than ever before. It is almost an unimaginable change. Transparent, accountable data. Transparent, accountable government. And that, they would call the data revolution. Now, in developed countries, we already have pretty good government. We have a lot of data. That's what the census departments are for, the national statistical offices. But it's already brought things like, how many of you used a navigation aid in your car? Probably most of you. Taxis use it, buses use it. Where do you think that comes from? It comes from this data revolution. The same thing is, how do you plan electric grids to make the energy in this country more efficient? It's particularly important because you have a lot of green energy, which is variable. So you need this sort of data to green the nation. It's important in precision health. So one of the spin-offs from my lab actually monitors people at work for the largest vertically integrated healthcare organization in the United States. If you have something wrong, like a heart problem, they put a little bit of software on your phone and they can watch so that if you are behaving oddly, the doctor gives you a call and says, what's up? This is transformative of healthcare because you get to people when they need it, not months later. It costs less, you're much more effective. Now, of course, these sorts of things have a cost. One of the costs is questions about privacy, questions about cybersecurity, and we have to take those into account, of course. And that's why here in Europe, you have the data protection acts which are moving forward. Over the last almost decade, I've run a discussion at Davos about this, which includes your chief regulators from Europe, chief regulators from the US, chief regulators from places like China, heads of major corporations. And there's very broad agreement among all these, which you might find surprising, that people have to be in charge of data about themselves. That seems to be the only politically viable method of moving forward. And corporations are okay with this because currently there are no rules. If there are clear rules, they seem to be happy with it. Now, that's not true for a lot of these little companies that are breaking the rules and doing sneaky things, and it's not quite true for some of the new internet giants, the Facebooks and Googles of the world. But it's going to be enforced for all the regulated industries and with these new data protection acts for the Googles and Facebooks of the world. To me, I started my career back when satellites were first put up, land use satellites. The United States invested in land use satellites to watch crops on Earth because there had been a famine that killed 2 million people in India. And nobody but knew about it. Nobody knew about it until the people were dying, until more than 1 million people were dead and it was too late to save another million. When those satellites were put up, it was extremely controversial here in Germany because the US was spying on you, right? We can see your houses, we can see your cars, we can see, right? How many of you are concerned about that today? It took a while. It took 10 years, 15 years, but controls were put in place. People learned what the real dangers were. Those were taken care of. It didn't happen overnight. But I'll tell you something that did happen overnight. There has never been a famine like that since. Today, when a famine happens, we know about it in time to get food there to save lives. That's the data revolution. Now, I want to say in my remaining 7 minutes here about something different that you can confuse with the internet and that version of the data lab, and that's the World Wide Web. So the World Wide Web is what you use when you browse. It's that interface. It's where most of the things people object to happen. It's where the Facebooks, the Googles, et cetera, of the world happen. And people are concerned about it in many ways. Job churn. It's disintermediating many jobs, causing changes in industry, in finance, in law, in many places. And we see ultra-rich people being created, fantastic fortunes in the US, in China, in other places. But we've seen this sort of thing before. It happened when railroads were first put in. There was a rush. Some people got incredibly wealthy. We saw it with oil. Rockefeller was the richest person in history. He gave away entire mountain ranges as gifts. Incredible wealth. We saw it with electricity. And now we're seeing it with the internet. And there's two stories that come with this. One is that most of the people involved in those rushes go bankrupt sooner or later. And we're left with railroads and the electric grid and other infrastructure, which defines our modern life. So their suffering is something that we have profited from. But the more interesting thing is that, at least in the United States and several other countries, those family fortunes that were so incredible are all gone. Within 2 to 3 generations, every single one of them dissipated. The Rockefellers are not poor today, but there are probably many people in the room here that are richer than they are. Think about that, right? That's the fourth generation now. The third generation was a little more wealthy. So I urge you to be a little patient and take a slightly longer view. I don't think we do need to take action. We are taking action. We need to take more action. But you don't need to run around like the sky is falling and we're all going to die. We've seen there before. We saw it with satellites, we saw it with oil, we saw it with railroads. We do have to ensure that there are jobs that replace the ones that disappear. We have to ensure that there's data privacy. And actually, there's a much more serious problem with the web that I want to draw your attention to that people don't talk about much. And that is that most of the discussions on the webs are driven by advertising and by advertising clicks. And what that means is all these news sources, all these social media, are driven by adrenaline, by being excited, by, you know, being sensational. And what you see as a consequence is people get into amazing fads, panics, all sorts of, you know, flopping this way and that way. And what that has seemingly done, and there's increasing evidence about this, is it's destroyed our capacity to have reasoned debate and come to reasoned solutions. Time and time again, we see the power of these social media to raise up concerns and panic people is destroying our ability to reach sensible agreements with each other. It is fixable. In research, you can actually set up different ways of doing this where people reach better decisions than we've ever been able to do before. But it's not by click-throughs. It's not by adrenaline. It involves feedback. It involves understanding how many people hold each sort of view. There's a whole sort of collective wisdom that you could get out of networks that we don't see today. And instead, we see destruction of consensus, destruction of culture. And a lot of what I think people react to about the web, about the bad, is this part. the fact that we've lost the capacity as a society for this sort of rational discussion that will lead to the sort of life that we want to lead. So I'll just stop there.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much. You have another 2 minutes, but you, please. Thank you so much, Sandy. That really comes as a surprise. So someone not using his full 15 minutes, but Andrew, you still have the right to do that. Stage is yours.
Do I get the extra 2 minutes of his? It wasn't a joke. It's greedy for data. Thank you, Sandy. That was a tremendous speech. Unfortunately, I agree with a lot of what you said, but I'm going to focus on what I disagree with. I guess we could divide the speech into two. When he began with the achievements of what we call the big data revolution, and he ended with the problems. And I think he did a tremendous job outlining the cultural problems of narcissism and intolerance. Maybe we can talk about that a little bit more. But he began in a very compelling way. I mean, he's, as David had suggested, Sandy is one of the most distinguished data scientists in the world, and he understands this stuff certainly better than I do. And a lot of what he said is extremely convincing. Will the data revolution improve our lives? And he talked about dead babies, or at least babies which would have been dead without big data and now are alive. Poor people, who I assume are less poor now because of the data revolution. Suffering people, electric grids, green, precision health, famines. And I think in those areas, Sandy is definitely right. The data revolution, big, small, whatever we want to call it, has the title of this thing is Will. So we're talking about the future, but let's just talk about the present and the past to date. So let's slightly change the title just for the moment. Has the data revolution improved our lives? And I'm not going to argue with Sandy on a lot of this stuff. I mean, I'm not an expert on, fortunately, on dead babies, but I think he's probably right. The data revolution gives more information to doctors. It's certainly good on the healthcare front. It offers huge potential on energy. There's certainly enormous potential when it comes to reinventing Africa, to enabling Africa to at least leapfrog on the mobile front over the industrial age and reinvent itself as a 21st century continent. The sharing of electricity through data, the environmental consequences, I think, offer a great deal of potential. So I wouldn't disagree with any of those things. But I think it's important to remember that when Sandy was articulating that, he's narrowing the debate. He's saying, will or has the data revolution improved our lives? And the criteria he's using is a strictly utilitarian one. Sandy's work, his excellent book, Social Physics, and his thinking, he's very much of a behavioralist. He sees things in very concrete terms, and in that respect, I think he's absolutely right. So in utilitarian terms, in the sense of, has the internet created more pleasure than pain? Of course, the founder of utilitarianism, Jeremy Bentham, invented that equation. The whole purpose of utilitarianism is to create more pleasure than pain. I think in those terms, Sandy is right, and I'm not going to argue on those fronts. Jeremy Bentham, of course, for those of you, I hope some of you have had a chance to read my book, Digital Vertigo. Jeremy Bentham never died. He was an early 19th century philosopher and social activist, and to sort of prove his commitment to pleasure over pain and the idea of transparency and the sharing of data, he left his body to the world. And if you go to University College now in London, you can see Jeremy Bentham's corpse. He's left in eternity, and in a funny kind of way, we've all become Benthams in this panopticon in our network. Bentham was also the person who invented the idea of the panopticon, of this hospital or prison or school where everyone was observable all the time. And Bentham believed that that would increase our pleasure, that we would work harder, that we would be more responsible, that it would actually develop our happiness. So in strictly utilitarian terms, I would agree with Sandy. In strictly utilitarian terms, the data revolution has improved our lives and will continue to improve our lives. I don't doubt that. There are always caveats, but generally I think he's absolutely right. But there are other ways, of course, to think about this issue, because the improvement of life is really about the good life. And the utilitarian position is only one tradition within that. There are many other philosophical traditions which think about the improvement of life, which aren't quantifiable, which aren't about making more pleasure than pain, which aren't about leaving your body for the benefit of the world. Let me mention a couple of them and then perhaps think about this big data revolution in the context of those. Aristotle, of course, the founder of Western philosophy in many ways, talked about the good life as the social life. The good life, the improvement of our lives, Aristotle being the founder of the idea of the polis and of communitarianism, argued that the good life was the social life, that the good life was a world in which we connected, in which we lived together. So the social was the good life. There are lots of other definitions of the good life. Marx, again, we're in Berlin, so perhaps it's appropriate to mention Marx. Marx thought of the good life in terms of work, in terms of the meaning we derive from work, from labor, from the humanity that arises from the creative process. He particularly articulated this, I think, as a young man, as an idealist in the German ideology. And then, of course, there was John Stuart Mill, whose book on liberty is the ultimate critique of utilitarianism. Mill, who was the godson of Bentham and brought up in the utilitarian tradition. His father was one of Bentham's great friends and one of the founders also of utilitarianism. Mill himself, who invented the term, ironically, John Stuart Mill invented the term utilitarianism, later came to critique it. He said it wasn't enough. It's not just about quantification. It's not just about measuring pleasure over pain. It's also about meaning, it's about poetry, it's about who we are, it's about separating ourselves from the crowd. It's about living in a more profound kind of way. And his book on liberty, for those of you who haven't read it, I would strongly suggest you look at it. So let's just take those three: the social, the ideal of work, and the notion of liberty, which Mill stressed represented an ability to separate ourselves from the crowd, to think differently, to be different. And of course, Mill came up with this term way before Steve Jobs. So has the data revolution improved our lives in that sense, in an Aristotelian sense, in a Marxist, or at least an idealistic Marxist sense, in terms of what Mill meant by on liberty? Now, David introduced the idea of the big data revolution as all of us working collectively to produce all this content. And he's absolutely right. This revolution is a profound structural shift in how we create value. You've all created value throughout the day. You've all been tweeting, you've all been up on Facebook, you've all been carrying your cell phones around with you. You're all essentially working for these large data companies. Some of you perhaps know you're working for these companies, others of you don't. And here, I think, is where one of the big problems, and I think Sandy touched on it in his speech, here's one of the great problems of this data revolution lies. We're all being exploited. We're all working in data factories. Mike Moritz's term, Mike Moritz being one of the most influential VCs in Silicon Valley. In the old industrial age, you worked in factories, you were paid for your labor. You worked for companies like Kodak, which employed hundreds of thousands of people, or Ford, or BMW, or many other industrial producers, but you were part of the production process. Today, we're all working for these big data companies, which are open, by the way, all the time. We're producing data, and all that data is going to these companies. We're producing value, but we're not paid for it. So every time we go on Google, we improve its logic. Every time we go on Facebook, we make that company more valuable. But we don't see any of it. So when it comes to labor, the fruits of our labor aren't being realized. It's not improving our lives. It's bound up in our economic crisis. As you have these more and more dominant companies, these companies are monopolizing not only capital, but also power. So Google and Facebook and many of the other Silicon Valley companies, these are the new monopolists. And as I argue in my book, the winner-take-all economy is lending itself to more and more inequality. This is not the good life. This is the opposite of the good life, of these large, these Leviathan media technology companies, which are appropriating our labor. When was the last time you were paid to contribute to Google or Instagram or Facebook? You were never paid. And worse than that, big data is undermining our employment. It's creating artificial algorithms, Google with Nest and more artificial intelligence companies, Facebook and many Amazon, many of these other companies are investing massively in artificial intelligence that will replace human labor. So artificial intelligence, this big data economy, is not improving the world. It's not making our lives better. I wouldn't say we're necessarily being enslaved. I think that would be an exaggeration. It'd be something that someone like Marx would argue. But we're not masters of this universe. The masters are in Silicon Valley. We're the serfs. We're the ones creating value and getting nothing in return. And of course, it's worse than that. It's worse than that in the sense that we're creating Bentham's panopticon. Every piece of data we're creating means we're watched more and more. Every time you do that Google search, every time you have that Facebook update, these companies know where you are. They know what you're thinking. They know what you're buying. This isn't the Stasi. In my book, I have a chapter on the Stasi. The Stasi kind of invented the internet in a funny kind of way. Milko wanted to aggregate data, but fortunately, 1989 meant he never could do it. This isn't the Stasi, this isn't Big Brother, this isn't totalitarianism. These companies want to profit from us, they want to know us intimately so they can serve up advertising, as Sandy said. This isn't the good life, this isn't making us happier. This means that we are being watched all the time. It's what Sandy's colleague at MIT, Ethan Zuckerman, who was one of the great idealists of the internet when it began, calls the original sin of the internet. The idealism has turned into a kind of nightmare. And the conformity, I think, is also deeply problematic. Mill talked about the good life in the sense of being able to escape the crowd, in being able to think for oneself. He thought about it in poetic terms. He thought about it in the consequence of mass society extinguishing that unique ability to think differently that drives civilization forward. Sandy, I think, touched on it very intelligently. This big data revolution is a revolution of conformity. It's a revolution where every community we go becomes mirrors to ourselves, mirrors in ideological terms, mirrors in narcissistic terms. This isn't the good life. This isn't enriching us. It's making us more and more solitary, alienated, atomized, lonely. Sandy's colleague at MIT, Sherry Turkle, has written some excellent books about this, one in particular, Alone Together. In this world of big data, we are alone together. That Aristotelian notion of the social, this idea that the network could bring us together because we're all on it, because we're all dots, because we're all part of this distributed system, is the biggest disappointment of all. So the good life is for the most part missing. Sandy's utilitarian optimism is correct, there's no doubt about that, but when it comes to everything else that can't be measured, we're lacking. The measurability of the web, of the big data revolution, is its great strength. But as Mill reminds us, as Marx reminds us, as Aristotle, as everyone who wrote persuasively about the good life, there's more to the world, there's more to our lives than measurability. So this is what we need to concentrate on. It's what can't be measured that isn't being realized. Until we address this, I'm afraid that I, in overall terms, disagree with Sandy. The big data revolution at the moment is not improving our lives. It may do, maybe we'll get onto this in the debate, but at the moment, it's failed. Our lives are more impoverished in spiritual, philosophical, cultural terms. We're poorer now than we were in 1989 when Tim Berners-Lee invented the World Wide Web. Thank you.
So now, Sandy, you have another five
Good.
Minutes to reply.
Yeah. So it's hard to rebut all of those things, but let me give you a shot. It's not complete disagreement. I think that a purely utilitarian view is a false view. Obviously, we want a richer life. And you heard about Aristotle, Marx, Stuart Mill, and there's many others, Sartre, all sorts of people. Which ones of those are right? Do you know? It turns out that if you look at all those philosophers and all the social scientists, that nobody really knows. There's lots of ideas about what the good life looks like, but there's never been a science of that. We've never actually taken it and gotten the tools of science to understand in a systematic way, where does creativity come from? Where does life satisfaction come from? What are the things that result in a good life when you look back at the end? What are the good things in the middle? These are all questions you can ask. You can ask people how they feel. You can ask people what they hurt, where they are happy. Not utilitarian, we're talking about value of life. And you can ask what are the conditions that led to that, but only if you have big data. The tools of social science are little lab things, they're surveys. They've never been able to answer these questions in all the millennia that we've been asking them. And that actually is what my book, Social Physics, is about. It says, for the first time we have the tools, not that we have the answers yet, but we have the tools to begin a scientific investigation of who we are as a species, what makes the rich life. For instance, the thing that I do say in the book is the source of creativity does not seem to be individuals. The evidence is overwhelming that that's not it. It's not the lone genius. It comes from social interaction. It comes from combining ideas from different people, from different communities. Creativity comes from diversity. And the people who are the so-called geniuses are really people that are very good at harvesting ideas. It didn't actually happen all inside their brains. Now, there's many other things to sort of understand, and we're just at the beginning of this road. But the biggest mystery out there is ourselves and our society. And for the first time, we have the hope of being able to understand those things. And that, actually, is also a data revolution that's sweeping the social sciences, because we can now make progress about understanding ourselves that we never could before. So I'd like to put that in because that's one of the most profound things that's happened in the last maybe century. Now, on the other things, there were lots of things you brought up. Fruits of our labor are not being realized. You know, until about 1990, 1995, libraries were seen as one of the most significant achievements of humankind. The library at Alexandria, the New York Public Library, those concentration of knowledge, which every single one of you beats by a factor of 10 because you have a cell phone and because you use Google. Now, you don't pay for that because you have to watch those stupid ads, okay? Evidence is people feel that's a pretty good trade-off. Maybe it's a bad trade-off. And if it is, we can fix it. But for right now, we are in an era that is incredible because for the first time, every human on Earth has the potential for access to all the knowledge on Earth. It's got lots of defects, I know, but stand back for a moment and ask how incredible that is. Monopolies. Well, you know, when oil first became a valuable commodity, Standard Oil in the United States monopolized it. And you know what the government did? It broke it up. See, government's a lot stronger than Google, and we're beginning to see that. We don't like the panopticon. Well, you know, there are things you can do about that. And Europe, and the United States, but Europe in the lead, is making steps with that with the Data Protection Acts. So this is the long view. Well, we've seen some great advantages. It's not all working. What we've got to do is we've got to shape the future. And we've got to shape the future. It's going to take a little while. It's going to take 10 years. It's going to take 15 years. We can't stop. We have to keep working to be able to get lots more of the good things and lots less of the bad things.
Thank you again, Sandy. I would have granted you another minute, but... Okay, so another rebuttal from your side.
I'm into rebuttals, especially when I get free white wine. You know, we've got 5 minutes here, so I can't get too complicated. But Sandy made two points, which I actually strongly disagree with. I agree with everything else, Sandy, but let's focus on the things we disagree with. He said something which I think is actually slightly outrageous. He said, up until the big data age, we as humans were, and I'm quoting him here, we were mysteries to ourselves. We didn't understand ourselves. Freud might say something about that. And so many other scientists and thinkers on the human condition. That we were mysteries to ourselves, and this data revolution, this transparency, this knowledge of suddenly we have this mirror where everything we do, everything we think becomes transparent, will enable us to understand ourselves. So self-awareness, self-knowledge, the mystery of the human condition has been fixed, I think Sandy was saying, by the big data revolution. We know who we are, we know what we want. But I think this is entirely wrong. Certainly Google knows what we want. Facebook knows what we want. Eric Schmidt said it famously. He said, he was being interviewed by the FT a few years ago when someone, and Eric Schmidt, I think, also drinks a bit too much white wine. He's sometimes a little too honest. He said he wants to know his users better than they know themselves so that when they wake up in the morning, he knows what they're going to do. He knows what new job they want. But we don't know ourselves any better by using these technologies. If anything, judging from media, from the crisis of culture, from the impoverishment of writing, I think we know ourselves even less well, even less intimately, and this scourge of narcissism. I've just spent the last few days traveling around Europe. Everywhere I go, people are snapping themselves. They're taking selfies everywhere they go. In Venice, in Rome, in Berlin, all they want to do is photograph themselves. I even went to Krakow and visited Auschwitz, and we had people taking selfies, probably to put up
you know, this is no joke on Facebook. Where's the self-awareness there? How do we know ourselves any better from this big data revolution? We are mysteries to ourselves, and that's what gives us our value. We don't know what we want, and the genius of Silicon Valley knew that better than anyone. Steve Jobs, lots of movies about him. Remarkable guy, may not want to work for him, but he was the great genius of Silicon Valley. A few years ago, he said, people want smartphones. They want to be able to swipe. They don't want the pads, the things that we usually used on computers. Everyone said, you're mad, no one wants that. He didn't use any industry research things. He had an instinct. He knew what we wanted before we knew it ourselves. So the success of the iPhone, which is fundamental in the big data revolution, was achieved by Steve Jobs, not because he went on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram, because he knew what we want because he was a genius. And that's got nothing to do with the social. Steve Jobs didn't sit around with people discussing the idea of the iPhone. So I strongly disagree with Sandy on the origins of creativity. That's an old, long-going debate. But I still think it comes from geniuses like Steve Jobs than from the collective. The other thing that I think Sandy said that is wrong is that somehow Google has replaced the Library of Alexandria. I was in Prague and I went to the old libraries full of wise old books. Google doesn't select. There's no curatorial quality to Google. There are no librarians working at Google. When you do a search, it generates the results according to the wisdom of the crowd and the interests of the advertisers who spend money on Google. Google is not the equivalent to the great Library of Alexandria. It doesn't create wisdom. It's corrupting minds, not because it's Google, because the links that Google serves up aren't curated. There's no thought behind it. You're just as likely to be sent to a pornography site or an advertising site, and even Wikipedia, without its editors, is by definition unreliable. So I strongly disagree with Sandy in the idea that, firstly, we're more self-aware, and secondly, we're more knowledgeable. If anything, I think we're more mysteries to ourselves than we've ever been, which isn't necessarily a bad thing, because I like mystery. But secondly, more problematically, I think we're more ignorant about the world, and it's one of the fundamental failures of the big data revolution. It was supposed to make us more knowledgeable, more worldly, but it's made us narrower, more narcissistic, more local. We live in what McLuhan said, the global village, but it's all village and no global.
I'm glad to see that although there's quite a lot of agreement, there's also disagreement, so that's good.
I obviously didn't express myself correctly when I said about knowing yourself. I don't think that Google or Facebook or anything allows us to know, or Silicon Valley, anything in Silicon Valley, allows us to know ourselves. It's in research labs and universities where people are able to use new types of techniques from things like cell phones, other sorts of instruments, that you're beginning to see a new type of social science. That social science is conducted under federal regulations for privacy, incidentally, that guarantee that people are opted in, know what's happening, and the data is religiously protected by federal penalties. But what it's doing is it's changing the face of the science of people. And you don't have to take my opinion for it. You can look at the most prestigious journals in the world, Science, Nature, and suddenly there's a new type of work there. And the new type of work has to do, by scientists, has to do with the dynamics of human society and the sources of behavior. And we're putting little stones to build a better, more accurate picture of who we are as a people. And the previous comments are a good example. What is the source of creativity? Steve Jobs was a genius. Steve Jobs said, there are no geniuses. It comes from people putting ideas together and then realizing when they talk to other people that it resonates. He got that right. That's what the data says. Now, you know, it's not finished science. Science is never finished. But that realization lets you build a society in which there aren't individuals who are the geniuses who are in charge. It builds a society of cooperation. It has fundamental political ramifications. The other thing about the Silicon Valley and the curation of books, it's a good point. I like Wikipedia better than I like Google. But the thing is that once you get everything in a digital format, you can begin to build curation. You can begin to build communities. You can make facts available to people. It's just beginning. Google is only a few years old. Every single person in this room was at least a teenager by the time that Google was founded. That's amazing, right? The transformation is just beginning. I think that Google is at real risk as a business model because it's not curated. I think someone will come along and do a better job, and I hope they will, make some competition. But in the meantime, I think the most valuable thing is that the data has done a revolution in science. And if you look at the premier, you know, journals in the world, it's just very clear that that's a consensus. There you are.
So now we come to the final part of the formal part of the debate. So Andrew, you have 3 minutes for the second.
Well, I wish I could get a response from Sandy on this, maybe later in the conversation, but I'd like some concrete examples. You said it's changing the face of the science of people. What do we know now from the big data revolution that we didn't know 20, 30, 50, 100 years ago? Give me concrete examples of how we know ourselves better now than we did before. So we can come back to that perhaps later. I don't know of any examples. I don't read the science journals. Most of you probably don't. And I don't see in science journals when they make profound breakthroughs, usually that filters down into popular culture, into books like popular writers like myself, into journalism, into television. I haven't heard of any new breakthroughs in terms of who we are, what motivates us. Sure, behavioral economics, but that wasn't founded on big data. Maybe, you know, and I think Sandy is a very smart behavioral economist in many ways, but we could have had Danny Kahneman without the big data revolution, and many of his breakthroughs don't depend on the big data revolution. So let me end. Will the data revolution improve our lives? This is a question about the future, not the present. I've made my point that at the moment, I don't think it's improving our lives. But it needs to. I'm not a reactionary. I'm not a Luddite. I'm not saying we can go back to the old world. So what has to happen? And I think Sandy touched on one thing that I disagree with, but it's an important thing about the future, expertise. One of the casualties of this big data revolution, of the democratization of culture, is the decimation of the authority of the expert, of the destruction of the curator, of the crisis of journalism. We're lucky enough to be in this wonderful building of one of the finest newspapers in Germany, but as everybody knows, in 20 or 30 years, this building may certainly exist, but the newspaper may not. We've had the decimation of the creative institutions, of newspapers, of the music industry, of writers. The expert is under assault in the big data revolution because we all think we're the fount of wisdom. We all do our updates. We all do our tweets and our Facebook and our Instagram updates, and we're not interested in listening to expertise. So I agree with Sandy. Google is vulnerable. It's vulnerable because it doesn't curate, because there's no expertise. It's not the Library of Alexandria. At least it's not the librarian of Alexandria. But what we need to get right is a new kind of expert, perhaps like Sandy. Data brokers, middlemen, who will educate and inform and improve the world. Because at the moment, this free market in data isn't working. It's leading to narcissism and chaos and a new kind of digital monopoly capitalism. So the challenge in the future to ensure that big data finally improves our lives, because it has to be, it's the great force of the early part of the 21st century, is rebuilding the expert, building the digital expert, the data expert, people who we respect, politicians, cultural figures, journalists. That's the challenge.
Thank you very much. So before I open the debate to the audience, and everyone can then, of course, make a contribution or ask a question, I would like just maybe follow this one thought a little bit more. How does creativity evolve? You obviously have different ideas about that, different conceptions of creativity. In your book, Social Physics, Sandy, you say creativity can be measured. It is actually a phenomenon that can be mathematically described, whereas you talk about the creative individual that we need, the expert, the individual who knows more than the others. So I get that sense that your idea or your concept of creativity is more a cooperative one, a collective one, whereas you have a stronger belief in the creative force of the individual. Can that be described that way? Or?
So this is the characteristic thing of social science, is that definitions of things are slippery. So when you want to measure something like creativity, you have to say what it is. Well, that's circular. you have to somehow figure out what it is. When I say that, what I mean is that we take broad ranges of examples of things where there are people in general agree that this is creative, that's not as creative. I don't know exactly what they're judging, but these are the humans out there saying that. And we ask, in what circumstances do they agree something's more creative? And if we take something that they agree is not creative and we change something about that circumstance, does it become something that the humans will say is more creative? And a good example is something that's familiar probably to all of you. If you take a corporation, typical corporations have these silos where people don't talk to each other outside their local environment. And if you break those silos up, the participants will agree that things have gotten more creative. What's happened? Well, the only thing, there's no more information there. What's happened is now people are talking to each other. There's more sort of shaping of ideas together. That's just one example. If that was the only example, I wouldn't make a claim like that. But there's, you know, dozens of examples. You wanted to know something that are sort of, you know, big. I think that's a good one. I mean, getting into, you know, what are the technical things and why people don't know about it. Revolutions take time in science. When anything happens, it's a really big change in science. You know, for the first 5-10 years, everybody ignores it. For the next 5 or 10 years, all the experts say, oh, we knew that all along. And then they say, well, no, it can't possibly be right. And then eventually they accept it. I guess I got those two back out of order. They say, it can't possibly be right. Then they say, well, we knew that all around. And then they say, well, yes, actually something happened. We're at the beginning there. But the thing is that now we can see for the first time that what the economists say is too limited. The model of economists is behavioral economics, which says that we're not completely rational. But economics is about individuals. And it turns out that in time after time after time, even in hardcore economics, it's social relationships that are the dominant thing. And on the surface, that's very obvious. Where do financial bubbles come from? It's not that everybody changed their brain, it's that they started talking to each other. They started to say, oh, hey, this is a good thing to buy. Tulip bulbs, good, right? Everybody sees what everybody else is doing. So the fundamental assumption of economics is around individuals, and that's wrong, just flat wrong. And now that we can actually measure the interaction between people and measure what they invest in and how it turns out, we can show that the social interactions, the learning from each other, are just as important, even in hardcore economics, as individual decisions. I can tell you some jokes about it, but, you know.
Let me just challenge you once more on this point. You wrote in your book that this exchange is only productive if it's diverse, if people of deviating different opinion, different viewpoints join in that exchange. If you only talk to peers who all have the same opinion, it's not particularly productive. Andrew's argument was that the internet is producing just that, a community of peers, and everyone
it's
just
talks to... It's one of the fundamental bad effects of the internet as it is today, is it reduces diversity. Reducing diversity leads to stupid decisions. So,
anything to add from your side, Andrew, or should we?
Mm?
Would you like to?
I still want to get back to Sandy. Give me an example, Sandy. You said it. You said we're a mystery. We're less of a mystery of ourselves now than we were. What have we learned over the last 25 years that we didn't know before?
Oh, the example of creativity. The example of the social, the role of social in economics. You can now write down a model, a formal mathematical model, of how people are influenced by their peers when they're making financial investments.
And but what's that got to do with creativity?
They're separate topics. One is about decision making. So I can look at return on investment, I can look at the quality of decision making as a function of your social interactions. That's dramatic because we all have suffered from financial bubbles that come from those social interactions. The creativity, we need a lot of innovation in our world. We face a lot of big challenges. Misunderstanding the sources of innovation and of creativity will mean that we'll choose the wrong solutions. If we choose the right solutions, we have a hope of addressing these challenges. That's why it matters. Why haven't you heard about it? Because it's controversial. It's debated. It's debated even in the sort of, you know, ivory towers of academics. And it will be for quite a while. But that's the way science works. Things come out, more evidence, people do more experiments. It either lives or it dies based on the data.
Well, I have to say, I'm not convinced. I don't see, you're not telling me what we know now through big data that we didn't know before. You're saying creativity is social, which is always, it's been an endless debate about whether creativity comes from single individuals, you know, the Steve Jobs, the Jesus Christ, the John Stuart Mills, or whether it's generated socially. That's an old debate.
Sure.
What's that got to do with social
media? But there's never been an answer. But there's never been an answer before.
But there still isn't an answer. I've already made the argument.
There is an answer.
There is not an answer. Steve Jobs had nothing to do with social. He sat in a room on his own. He was the most obnoxious guy.
Except that he says that the way he was creative was social. It was not in his head. It was assembling other people's ideas.
Look.
That's a quote from Steve Jobs.
He said he was playing the
orchestra. So let's take it back to Mill. So Mill's response to Bentham was that people have to stand outside convention, outside orthodoxy, to drive the world forward. No one would deny that you can't live in a cave. Everyone has, there's always social knowledge, social impact, social consequences. You know, Steve Jobs lived in the world, but the reality was is that he came up with this idea on his own, and he bullied it through, Had he been working at Microsoft, it never would have happened. Had he been working probably at Google, it wouldn't have happened. So I strongly disagree with you that creativity is social. Secondly, I don't see any evidence that big data has proved it. And thirdly, I think the example of Apple and the iconification of Jobs, which in some respects is justified, proves that. You know, Jobs was
Except that Jobs himself said that's not true.
Yeah, but that's your only argument. Jobs said it wasn't true.
And the papers and the best journals say it's not true.
But Jobs was the most obnoxious person who bullied everyone around.
who
ran the company like a tyrant and only...
Now, if you said that Jobs being able to execute was because of his personal talent, I would agree with you. The force of a particularly a violent leader like him causes things to happen. But there are also consequences to that we're just beginning to understand.
And I think, but here's the bigger point here. Not that that wasn't a big point. The bigger point is Mill was writing in the 19th century. Mill could retire into his study, could go to Italy, could spend time with a woman he loved. He was able to escape society. In the panopticon we're living in this Twitter, Facebook, Instagram infested world of 16, 17-year-olds, you can't escape that. Where is the room for the heretic? Where is the room for the million or the Jobsian figure who has the bravery, the willingness to stand outside the world? I would argue that in the age of big data, along with all the surveillance-style nature of this economy and society, it's harder and harder to fight orthodoxy. It's harder and harder to be creative. So will the social revolution, will the data revolution improve our lives? It might do, but we need to rebuild that dark room, that place that you can escape the social. Sandy thinks the social is the heart, the engine of creativity. I think that's where our core difference lies. I disagree. We need that dark room, that place you can escape from the glare of Mark Zuckerberg's global dorm room. We need a place where individuals are able to create, and you laugh, but that's what he said,
where
individuals are able to create themselves. The great mystery of self-creation can't be quantified. It can't be represented on things like this. It needs to take place in a dark room. We need to be able to escape society. And I fear that Sandy's ideology of the social is playing a role, not in the creation of creativity, but in undermining.
So you misunderstand what I said.
Me?
What I said was, it requires diversity of ideas coming from different communities. If it's a homogeneous community, you don't get creativity. You get staleness.
But Sandy,
that dark room, that the reason for privacy, the core reason for privacy, is that without it, you don't get innovation.
Ding, we're in total agreement
there. You need to be able to stand away from the crowd. You need to have other communities that you talk to, other examples that you can see and imagine in order to reinvent yourself in your society. And I would agree with you that the current way things are happening on the internet, on the web, is not promoting that. And it's destructive in many ways. It's destructive of innovation. And it also is destructive of the process of bringing the ideas together. The Twitter sphere is not a place for contemplation and innovation. It's a place for madness.
And what we need to do, and I couldn't agree more, what we need to do then to guarantee that this data revolution improves our lives is to figure out how this network world learns how to forget. It knows how to remember, but it's the forgetting that's all important. Again, speaking in Berlin, the importance of forgetting is everything. It's the foundation of creativity. It's the ability to leave one's past. The ability to reinvent oneself. Again, I keep on coming back to Steve Jobs, but the remarkable thing about Steve Jobs, he was able to reinvent himself perpetually, his ideas, his identity. And you know, his second or third coming, he was a better Steve Jobs, and that's what we need to guarantee. And the problem with the big data revolution is we can't escape our past, because everything is remembered.
Gentlemen, it's a pleasure to listen to both of you, and I'm impressed. It's actually an example of cooperation that even you organize your time.
It's not social, kind of
fairly. And
yes, it is.
And I feel very bad interrupting you, because it's really very illuminating and also very entertaining. So thank you, both of you, for this official part of the debate. Thank you. So. So let's now have a look at what our audience here in the room and the people who watched us on the live stream say about the motion. Can we see the result of the Mentimeter vote? Here it is. Does the data revolution improve our lives? So 40% say yes, 44% say mainly yes, ambivalent, 11% mainly no, 0% no, Oops. It's moving.
You're moving the results here. What's going on?
Yeah, okay, I do it here. Okay, so does anybody, the two of you, want to comment on that? What do you?
It shows how it shows how unreliable data is.
I think it shows that humans are basically optimistic.
There's zero for mainly no.
Good.
Where are the mainly no's?
Oh, but look, it's only 49 votes. That's not big.
That's not big, no.
Right. That's small data, that's minute data.
Maybe people have forgotten.
Minuscule data.
With four categories, the error bars on those are large. Yeah.
Well, can we have some comments from the audience? It's supposed to be a democratic thing.
Okay.
Don't pay attention to your phone.
No. I know. See, you know, it's just lonely people talking to themselves. No, I'm actually looking at our questions from Twitter. And I thought this is so. I think this is a very interesting one. I would really like to start with a contribution from the Twitter crowd. And this is a question from C2 Kane. And the person asks, but what about empowerment? Tech has empowered voices that would have been heard before enabled ideas to flourish. So, and we had another tweet going in the same direction. So,
can you say that again?
Okay, so it's to Andrew Keen, but what about empowerment? Tech has empowered voices that would not have been heard before.
Correct.
It enabled ideas to flourish. Another tweet was going in the same direction, saying, you know, the internet and digital media give a voice to those people who would have been unheard. So that, you know, might be a bit of a challenge to your idea that it creates monopolies, that it creates inequality, and that usually the weak ones do not have a voice. Many people argue, you know, the very opposite direction. You know, think about the Arab Spring or other protest movements. The internet gives people a voice.
Well, I have a simple response to that. What about the Arab Spring?
Arab Spring's a good example of what, yes, people had a voice, but how did it turn out? A voice is not the same thing as galvanizing people into coherent decisions and organizations. And so the question is the difference between a voice and an effective voice. Yes, you can be heard, but if you can't organize into something that has a lasting effect, have you really been heard? And current media are not well suited towards actually changing the world. They're well suited towards creating panics.
And, you know, we're in Berlin. You guys have a interesting history of plebiscitary democracy. I mean, the idea that you do away with the politicians and everyone has a voice and that somehow benefits everyone, I think is wrong. It comes back to Sandy's point about expertise. One of the great cultural crises of our age is our distrust of politicians. What we're doing is idealizing the outsider. We're idealizing the Le Pens and the Corbyns and the Syrizas and the Podemoses, all who are critiquing the system. So the system is being undermined, but we don't really have much credibility, and we've forgotten about the credibility of the politician, of the expert. Now, politicians often don't deserve that. They haven't done, especially in America, they haven't done a great job. But in Germany, I think they have done a good job. And I think we need, well, certainly better job than in the US. No? No?
So we have microphones in the room. Please use a microphone if someone from the audience would like to make a contribution so we can hear it on the live stream as well. We have the gentleman here on the right. Do you want to object to that? Okay, and then gentleman here on the left. Okay, the microphone, where do we have it? Here it comes.
This is the mob now.
So I want to pose a question, and I was the first, and I'm female.
Ah, okay.
And you're only men here tonight.
Sorry, I could see. Could you please introduce yourself?
Thank you. So my name is Valerie Lux-Schul from the Humboldt University of Berlin. I have a question to you, Mr. Keen. I find it quite absurd that creativity comes from dark rooms. When I think of my own life,
Have you ever been in a dark room?
No, I'm not coming from a dark room. The most creativity I experienced was always together with people and was with the internet. Because the internet also satisfies my curiosity. All the time I want to explore something new, I want to find out something new, I want to be creative, I just go to Google, type it in, I get more inspiration. The internet connects me also with other people who have the same inspiration, we can share, and from this we have creativity. And the next thing, you always said that we are in Berlin. You know what in Berlin is? There's also the founder of the feminist Twitter called Aufschrei, where some female or feminist groups together who were discriminated by men collected their experiences in a Twitter account. And so they had more collective power and could more bring into public and to democracy. And I think this is very, very important, except a dark room for only a rich man like James Mill.
Wow, did it. So I didn't say that only men could go in the dark room. I mean, women are allowed too. Okay, so you've made your point. Give me an example of this creativity that Twitter has unleashed in you. Tell me, what has it enabled?
So, for example, please could you use the microphone so we can hear you.
And women can be creative. I don't deny that.
Thank you. No. So the thing is, it all started when a politician made a sexist remark about the breasts of another journalist. And because of this, she posted it on Twitter. All other women in that sense felt empowered also to put up a post and tell about experiences and form a new form of feminism called the net feminism. So they are creative in that way that they could share together and be collective in their experience. And they did not know that the others had that experience as well if it would have been not put on Twitter.
But what was newer? I mean, men have been making remarks about breasts since even before the internet.
It was new because it could be distributed and everybody could read it.
But what's creative about that? I mean, Sandy talks about, and I agree with him, the importance of creativity. You could have done that in the bar down the street.
Nobody knew about it.
Well, so let me just suggest something that's also interesting that may be missing from the questions and answers here is that, you know, the things we've examined suggest that if you're going to actually change things, you start with something like Twitter, which alerts people, but the actual change comes from richer channels of communication, from face-to-face communication, from other sorts of richer social networks. Because it's those sorts of relationships that end up galvanizing people to action. People get galvanized to action from Twitter, but only when they're almost ready to do it already. So if you look at these networks, you find that underneath a lot of them, there is a physical network of relationships also that is equally important. I have some friends that were key in the Egyptian part of the Arab revolution, and they make the point that they all knew each other and organized with each other long before the revolution. They knew who to trust, who not to trust. They knew how to speak to each other. And the electronic things were important in galvanizing other people, but underlying that were these more richer, I would say more human, sort of oriented networks. And that's typical of the things that really happen. It's not so much just the digital stuff. It's the other sorts of parts of our lives, these other sorts of networks that are perhaps even more effective, not for the alerting, but for the galvanizing to action.
I think that's one of the, and it's ironic, one of the unintended consequences and where the data revolution may improve our lives. I think Sandy got it absolutely right. What the digital big data revolution has done is commodified the digital. And at the same time, it's created new value. The new value is in the physical. The new value is in events like this. The new value is in meeting. And the great challenge for how we beat the machine, how we outrun the machine, which is more and more all-knowing, more and more replicating what we do in the 21st century, is discovering what it means to be human, the complexity, the ambivalence, the unknowingness of it. Maybe not it's a dark room, but it's not quantifiable. And one of the ironic, perhaps an unintended consequences of why the data revolution will improve our lives, because it will remind us of what it means to be human. We never needed to think about that in the past because we never had competition. Now we have competition. Now we have machines that replicate most of what we do. So we've got to think to ourselves, how can we outrun? How can we beat the machine? How can we be more human?
Can I just one question?
Sorry, may I just ask one? I'm not sure whether the point or the question, also, as I said, there are many tweets going in that direction, and the question was also going in that direction. How do social media change political and public discourse and the culture? Is it all hysteria, or is it not also empowering those who maybe in the past would not have had access to the channels to express
their
concerns?
Clearly you get new voices, and for instance, the one of the great attractions for instance, the United Nations is that you get to hear voices you've never heard before. I mean, before, you know, you would have horrible things happen and no one would even know that they're there. So that is certainly true. On the other hand, it's not sufficient. You need to be able to not only know something, you need to come to action. And action requires more engagement, more longer-term engagement. It tends to be associated and I'm not saying this as a, you know, like a lawful thing, but it tends to be associated with these older types of network, these face-to-face networks of trust, to be able to have sustained action to do something about injustice that's happening to these new voices. So the communication is part of the solution, but we have to integrate that into the human system to make it effective. And let me just add one thing. So people are all scared about AI. AI is going to take away your jobs. It's really interesting to look at that a little bit more because, you know, the best chess players in the world are not machines and they're not humans. They're humans. Like the best chess players in the world are a couple of mid-level chess players with a bag full of laptops, right? And the lap and the computers do tactics and the humans do strategy.
So
think about Google. You know what Google is? All you humans make links on the web. And all Google does is feed you back the statistics about that. Google is a very poor type of AI. It's really collecting human action. And again, when you look at all these examples of AI, they're either profoundly uncreative, they're just repeating rote things, or the genius comes from the gathering of different people in this organization that is, or this forum that is electronic and machine-based in some way.
Okay, since we have already entered the floor a bit, I see, Andrew, you want to react to that, but maybe we'd like to hand over here to the gentleman who's already waiting with the microphone.
Can I just say one brief thing in response to what Sandy said? I agree with him, we're not on the verge of singularity. Machines aren't gonna rule us. But the a very good American economist, Tyler Cowen, teaches at George Mason University, wrote a book called Average is Over. The challenge and the problem in this big data age is a new class of individuals who work with machines, a new master class, the destruction of this, the hollowing out of the middle class, and this underclass of people who serve this new Uber class. So the problem is, what are most people going to do? Sure. Some people will work with machines. Some people become chess champions. Some people will leverage the intelligence of machines to build new businesses. There's no doubt about that. I don't buy Ray Kurzweil's idea on the verge of singularity. But the great challenge is, what are most of us going to do? Most of us who, in reality, for better or worse, are average.
Okay, now,
sir.
Gentlemen, in the first place.
Thank you very much. So it was some minutes ago that I heard this nice sentence that politicians are so good. Oh no, I'm a German. And now I have heard a very right sentence from our Minister of Finance. There is a big avalanche coming down to Germany. It has just started by perhaps a single person, my words, with a silly, really expensive selfie, and we are, as a society, as a German society, we are on the brink to be destroyed here. A lot of persons, hundreds, thousands of persons, had come over the frontier, the green frontier, with, or border, you may say, without being registered. We don't know how many people are here. We don't know how many people are registered here. And our politicians are good working with their brains? Oh, come on. It's okay. A nice joke. So, really, sorry that I'm...
No, I mean, you certainly touched upon a very important topic, and this is the current and ongoing refugee crisis, you may call it.
It's also an issue in the United States.
So what...
Where we have, I think it's
Can big data 12, help, Cindy?
We have 12 million, by current estimates, unregistered immigrants. Can big data do something about it?
Yes, I mean, well...
Well, big data does some things about it. I don't think it's the answer. But at least the big data that I've seen, and you won't like this, says that those people turn out to be really pretty good citizens if they're given a chance.
Yeah, let me introduce myself. I'm Thomas Wiegand. A couple of years ago, I wrote a video compression standard, which is now used everywhere, half the bits, and I'm running the Heinrich Hertz Institute here in Berlin. And I've been thinking about the stuff that you guys been talking quite a bit, but I have a few different angles. Well, big data, for example, is the major reason why today people with HIV have a much longer life expectancy. The cure is based on this thorough data analysis. There's lots of progress that we see. Actually, data science is the major engine behind science and engineering as we see it. And the discussion about whether or not we have this life in a certain sense that is getting better in the face of having 6.5 billion people that live much worse than us here in the more developed world is I kind of a little bit cynical, because we have a water crisis, we have an energy crisis, we have a climate crisis, and you can make this list longer. And we need to solve it, we need to be more efficient. The new stuff that we have to come up with has to be also more efficient, not only by using more carbon, it has to be more efficient in terms of just be better, and because it has to be sustainable for 10 billion people that we'll soon have. This is the one side, the hope side that I'm seeing with the subject, and I'm thinking about it, that we are researching cancer and whatever, what have you. The second part is the fear part, is something that I'm observing for quite a while, which is the it's just a development that is scaring me, which is the accumulation of wealth. I'm fine with people making money over there, be getting a return, and you know, when they found a company, when they do something good, they can make some money. That's fine. However, the billionaires on this planet, they accumulate, they increase their wealth by 20% a year or even more. Any process that increases that much, and it comes up to the big companies, etc., is unstoppable. They own the press, they own the politicians, they start to own everything around. I know it sounds a little bit like one of these movies, but if you look at the data, it's getting there. So I'm having this, I'm with Sandy Pentland on one side, and I'm with you on the other side. I'm toggling, but I have a slightly different view, and I think the discussion that we've seen on the social media part of this is a bit like, could be the starting of a movie that Charlie Chaplin would have made about the data revolution instead of the industrial revolution.
So let me just say something about the accumulation of wealth. I mentioned that historically they've seen these sorts of things. In the late 1800s in the United States, those people were called robber barons. And what society did is taxed them, broke up the monopolies, and the money went away. In Latin America, they didn't do that. And today, there are 50 families that own 80% of the entire economy, all the value. And as a consequence, there's not a lot of innovation in Latin America. They have a lot of problems of that. And I've sort of worked with these people side by side a little bit, and it's a very different world. Europe has some of this problem, too. You have family fortunes that have persisted for centuries. That's surprising, actually. One might want to ask about that. Like you, I'm all for sort of accumulation of wealth, but I want it to be transitory. I don't want people to have permanent dominance. It is notable that a large fraction of these people have signed a pledge to give away at least half of their money. In America, yeah?
Not the Russians, not the Chinese.
Well, it's also notable that the Russians and Chinese are trying to get their money out of their country as fast as they possibly can, because they know that it's a bubble. But, yeah, this is an issue.
Well, Sandy, this is absurd. I mean, you're suggesting that somehow the American oligarchs are more moral than the Europeans?
No, the European system it's enables, against their will.
The Rockefellers and the Carnegies, I don't believe that, especially given the American taxation system, I don't believe that the American system undermines wealth more than the European. If anything, I think the reverse is true. But that aside, let's go back to this gentleman. I want to go back to this guy, because I think he's entirely wrong. You know, he got very excited and emotional about how evil politicians are. And, you know, I'm a great admirer, actually, of Angela Merkel. I think she's one of the few politicians in the world today with moral credibility and a political spine. But the reality is, in this world of big data, as we have these huge global companies with enormous power, with enormous wealth, you know, Jeff Bezos just, I think he's just, his personal wealth now is 50 billion. Page and Brin at Google are almost close to that, Zuckerberg. The reality is that we only have the politicians to protect us, to save us. There's no third way. Now, Sandy, I think, incorrectly said that society saved the world from the oligarchs of the industrial system. It wasn't society, Sandy. It was the political system. It was unions. It was political parties. It was the emergence of the labor movement.
Yep.
And I think we have to go back to the fact that we need to remain, that we need to maintain credibility of politicians. And if we fall into the trap of the gentleman in the front who trashes politicians, who undermines the credibility of those people with authority, of typical political, of parties, of ideologies, then I think there's a huge problem. Because then you have these huge multinational corporations, the Apples, the Googles of the world, and there's no way to control them. So we need a strong politics, and the great challenge is rebuilding the credibility. And to go back to social media, one of the problems with social media is it's used to chip away against the authority. It's used to undermine the credibility of politicians, to create these overnight sensations with millions of followers. But the reality is to govern, we need expertise, we need political professionalism, we need people we can trust. The great scarcity, and as I think Sandy indicated, the scarcity of our age, ironically, given the transparency of this new world, is trust. So how do we build that trust, or how do we rebuild that trust? Maybe we need new political parties, new ideologies in this new age, but it has to happen. We can't be left with just social media. We can't just be left with Wikipedia. We can't be left with a world where all the gatekeepers are swept away and all we have is the mob, because I think that is truly dangerous.
Okay, before we enter into another exchange between the two of you, we'd like to again give the opportunity to for contributions from the audience.
Thanks very much for the debate so far. It's very interesting. And actually, it ties quite well my question to what you're discussing at the moment. because, I mean, big data is there, and it's not only about social media. I totally agree with you. I think that's actually maybe a bit of a sideline. It's a lot about metadata and so on. And so I'm wondering, what's your position on regulating that kind of exchanges and the flow of information, and what is actually being recorded and what not, and who records what where and so on? So how this should be regulated? What are your positions on that? And what do you think about internet governance about those tendencies?
You know, it's complicated. We've done a lot showing, for instance, the danger metadata. Eve, who's sitting right there, and I wrote a paper that was in sort of the preeminent science journal showing the data danger of metadata, and that was cited by the U.S. Supreme Court as the main evidence shutting down some of the NSA programs. So you can sort of see what side we're on. On the other hand, you know, you can invent architectures that do some of the things that are surprising. Like, for instance, currently we have a computer architecture that allows you to answer questions without sharing joint questions without sharing data. It cures a lot of the problems in the financial industry, where, for instance, the crash came from not sharing data that was private, but now actually you could have foreseen it by using some of these new things. But all of those are just little pieces to a much bigger puzzle. And that's why, you know, I started this group at Davos all those years ago, is because we need to talk about this. We need to decide what is the right deal. I call it the New Deal on Data. That was a convening thing. And the New Deal was to give people more power over their data. Where the limits of that are, well, you know, in Europe here, you're enacting these data protection acts. That's one take on it. There's a safe harbor debate where is U.S. compliant with the EU rule? And the secret is that a lot of the EU, U.S. regulators like the European rules, and so we'll find some more harmonization there, maybe with some bumps in the middle. And then one of the big issues has to do with the security agencies, Germany as well as the U.S., because it's not a friendly world out there. I can tell you things that would, you know, make you not sleep tonight. And so we have to be, unfortunately, a little practical about who can get at what data. And I don't think it's resolved. It's a deep and difficult debate. Is how much protection is required? What do we give up to achieve that protection?
Well, I'm asking myself those questions as well, so I was hoping that maybe you, as an expert or somebody who has thought about it a bit longer, can give me a bit of an answer and not ask me something back. And I do.
The short answer is I think that there are technical and legal means to protect your data and put you far more in charge of it than ever before. I think we can put the genie back in the box with Facebook and Google and things like that. I think it will take years. I think it will take 5 or 10 years to put that back completely, but that it will happen. I'm a little less confident when it comes to security agencies, because threats from some of the actors in the world are real. And again, you know, it's not just, oh, they're seeing our data. It enables things which are really hair-raising. And I don't think we've even begun to have that debate about data yet. We've done a little bit. They put some of the NSA, American NSA, back in the box. I don't think there's been much that's happened to the German agencies that were doing similar things. I don't think there was much that's happened to the UK. Everybody's doing this. And we don't control most of that. So I think it's maybe the next big topic we want to get to is what price security?
One last take before you hopefully also give me an answer. Who is the we? Because you're talking we can put Facebook back.
I'm assuming that in I'm talking to a roughly democratic population that has the ability to influence politics, the ability to elect leaders, and the ability to influence the laws that are made. That's the we that I'm talking about, right? That may not exist. There are certainly problems in that. But in the end, that's what needs to happen.
So, to respond to your question directly, I'm in principle in favor of a law of forgetting. I think probably the current legislation may need some tweaking, but the notion of a law which legislates forgetting, I think, is important, because I think what the internet hasn't remembered how to do is forget. But having said that, and I also think that there is a need for regulation when it comes to antitrust, and Google in particular's ability to take different pieces of its business to use, say, the Android store, the App Store, to crush anti-advertising apps. I'm a great admirer of Margaret Vestager, and I think she's an example of, I don't know whether she's a politician or a trust buster or a bureaucrat, but someone, to come back to the gentleman at the front, someone we should admire. Someone we should think, this is someone who's standing up for the benefit of society. This is someone who cares about justice. This isn't just another corrupt or self-interested or useless politician. Having said all those things, though, I think we need to remind ourselves of business model. It's all too easy to blame big companies. It's all too easy to blame the Facebooks and the Googles. And particularly, I think, in Germany, you know, one of the reasons I always get invited to speak is because I'm critical of Google. But it's not Google's fault. Google is a prisoner of its business model, which relies on the acquisition of our data to sell advertising. But consumers also have a responsibility. It's all too easy to feel the victim. Some of you may have articulated that ideology this evening, the notion of this, of all of us being the perpetual victim of being exploited by one force or another. We have to acknowledge that the business model of the internet, the current internet, the current big data economy, of giving out these wonderful technologies and services and platforms for free, whether it's, you know, the Facebook social network engine or Google search or Instagram photography. It's free. It seems too good to be true, and it is too good to be true, because when we use these services, they're collecting our data and they're exploiting our privacy. Now, of course, they have something to answer for there, but we do too, because we shouldn't be that naive. We're not that naive in other worlds. When we walk into a store and the guy at the till rubs his hands and says, you can have anything in the store for free, we'd say, what? What do you mean? If we went into a restaurant and said, you can have anything on the menu for free, you'd say, there's a trick here, and there is a trick, and we need to grow up. We can't have everything for free, whether it's on the internet or in the world or in the big data economy. We need to take responsibility. The problem with the internet and the digital revolution is it's been all about rights. We need to learn responsibilities. Politicians do, security agencies. Everyone has something to answer for. But we're not the innocents here. We need to take responsibility. We need to think this thing through. We need to understand that there are no free lunches, and that technology needs to be paid for, that there needs to be a more coherent, cogent, concrete economic model, because otherwise we become the product.
Andrew, if I may just interrupt you here, we actually asked our audience to vote on this particular question. Would you
the audience
rather,
is corrupt, though,
you know, pay for a service or, you know, take it for free and give your data? So could we have a look at the result of the second part of our survey, which we did online? Here it is. So, many providers of free internet services gather the user's personal data. I would prefer to pay for the service and not have my data gathered. 29% not to pay for the service and permit my data to be gathered. 23%. And then, of course, the others are probably...
So I won here, right?
Did even not take part.
52 votes, it's not exactly... That's not big data, Sandy, is it?
No. No. It's probably near the error bars, though.
But nonetheless, I mean, we talked a lot about choice, choice, giving the consumer, giving the internet user the opportunity to choose for himself what he wants, what he doesn't want.
you know, in reality, this is very hard to realize. Sometimes, you know, it might be, it can be realized, but it's also the inertia on the side of the user. So, what, you know, should we have more of these models? Are there not enough alternatives, giving, you know, allowing the customer to have ownership of the data and just rather decide to pay for it rather than giving access?
So you're asking about what should the business models be?
Should there be more models that allow?
Well, obviously there should be more models, right? There should be competition. I wish there was an anti-Facebook that you know, I could control my data, and it was my data, not their data. It's hard to get these things at scale, but people, I can think of a few actors that could do it and may do it. So, you know, these things, I mean, it's interesting to notice that 10 years ago, if we had this conversation about threats of these big companies, we would all be talking about Microsoft. And since then, it's lost half of its stock value. It's gotten locked out of mobile computing, which is the main source of computing going forward, completely. And, you know, we don't talk about it as a juggernaut anymore. Some of its main sources of cash could conceivably go away very quickly. It is possible to change. That look so immutable, and a lot of that had to do with customers. That was sort of your point, was that, you know, we chose to use this rather than that. We can choose again. There are barriers to having choice, and that's where things like regulation come in, is to be able to offer other models in a fair sort of a way that has a chance of competing against established entrants.
But regulation and innovation go together. I completely agree with Sandy's point about Microsoft. But Microsoft was hobbled not by consumers, but by regulators. When Microsoft went after Netscape and tried to sort of monopolize the browser market as it monopolized so many other markets, finally the regulators both in the US and Europe woke up, and Microsoft was hobbled. And what came out of that? This is really important to remember. Without that case, you never would have had Google and Facebook. You never would have had Web 2.0. But we're back at the same point where the monopolists have reappeared, not because they're bad, not because Google or Facebook or anything or Amazon are bad, because the laws of digital economics lend themselves to monopoly, which is why regulators and politicians are so important. I think Sandy's right when it comes to alternatives. The reality is we haven't had a crisis, a real crisis in big data. We haven't had Exxon Valdez. We haven't had Chernobyl. When that happens, then people are start going to look seriously at alternatives to Facebook and Google. There already is an alternative to Google, which is very privacy-friendly, which is DuckDuckGo. But it's still a search engine which only kind of technology purists and ideologues flock to. But if Google got hacked, for example, which I think one day probably will happen, if everything that we do on Google suddenly was revealed to the world, then suddenly we'd wake up. And it's rather like the environmental movement. It's rather like waking up to the reality of industrial technology on the environment. We only wake up at the last minute, perhaps also all too often too late. But at the moment, this is all theoretical, at the moment there haven't been any really profound data breaches, but they will come. And when they come, then these issues become a lot more pertinent, and the alternatives to the free services of the Googles and Facebooks, which turn us into the product, then become a lot more attractive.
Andrew, talking about alternatives, may I confront you with a voice from the Twitter cloud saying, Andrew Keen using Twitter doesn't feel quite right.
What do you mean, me using Twitter?
Yeah, why do you not use Twitter, maybe something else, or just prefer the, you know, the dark room, or you know, direct conversation?
So it's hard to annoy me, but that is a really annoying question.
Well, I'm not asking.
Let me explain. Firstly, you know, Sandy and I had this conversation earlier. One of the challenges of this debate is to get beyond this Luddite utopian dichotomy, the idea that either you live in a cave or you go to MIT or Silicon Valley and surround yourself with screens. The reality is that we all need to be on these platforms. You know, I'm critical of Twitter. I'm not on Facebook, but I am on Twitter because as a writer, as I've joked or half joked, you know, a writer who isn't on Twitter should have their writing hand chopped off. We need these platforms. They're the reality of networked 21st century life. If I want to sell my books, my speeches, my services, my consulting, I have to be on these services. But at the same time, I can be critical. We have to realize that you're not either in favor of destroying or switching off the network, of destroying big data, or embracing it absolutely. I think one of the really encouraging things of this debate, you know, clearly Sandy and I don't agree on everything, but what's really striking about this conversation, Sandy at MIT Media Labs, me as the, you know, so-called antichrist, we actually agree on what, 60 or 70% of this stuff? So we got to get beyond either being entirely against or entirely in favor. The reality is we're all somewhere in between. We're all ambivalent. We're all not sure. We all embrace some of these services. We're ambivalent about others. No one wants to be watched. No one wants to become the product. But at the same time, we have to be on these services. The only people who can afford not to be on Twitter and Facebook and email are either the super rich or the super poor. But the rest of us, it's our fate. It's the reality of early 21st century life.
Gentlemen, we have now been discussing for, sorry, I have to interrupt here. We have now been discussing for almost 2 hours, and I am afraid we will have to close the debate for today.
Okay.
But now you both know.
Sandy finish.
Absolutely. But now you will both actually get 3 minutes for a closing remark. And I would now suggest that you, Sandy, start off. You have 3 minutes for you for
wrapping up. 3 minutes.
You can also do it in one, and then you get it.
I just wanted to follow on what Andrew was saying, because I think it's right. It's very easy to be critical. It's very easy to be alarmist. But that's not important anymore. We're all alarmed, okay? We've thought about it. What we need to do now is come up with solutions. And we need more just than solutions. We need to have a conversation that results in action. I'm not going to tell you what that action is. I have my own opinions. One of the reasons I'm here is to talk to you, to hear what you say, for you to hear my ideas about it, so that we can decide what do we need to do next, and even much more importantly, what do we want in the long term? Where are we going? What sort of life? We're not going to get rid of all the big data. We're not going to get rid of the internet. Why? Because it gives us some fundamental capabilities, not only that we want, but in an age of global warming and other sorts of challenges, we need. That's why the UN endorsed this notion of a data revolution. It's important. But what are the boundaries? Who controls it? Do you control the data about you? I think that's a fundamental thing. Your digital identity should be something that you control, that you have a say about, just like you have a say about your physical identity. In these societies that we live in, it took us hundreds of years to fight for the rights to our physical identity. It used to be that the king owned you. And that's a few hundred years ago. And we had to fight, and there were wars, and people died to be able to get to a place where we have a certain amount of freedom and privacy in our physical lives. All the digital stuff, our digital identity, has sprung to life in only the last couple of years. It's a baby. But what we need to begin doing is establish who owns our digital identity, how does that interact with society, what are the taxes we have to pay. We do have to contribute to the common. That's how we create the civilization. You can't have complete privacy. Sorry, it's not good, it's not plausible. But you do need to have a certain amount of self-determination, and I think it very much is like the battle for our physical identity and our physical independence. And we're at the beginning of it. This will happen, Google will come and go, Facebook will come and go, the current data regulations will come and go. We will evolve towards something else. Think about where you want to be. For your grandkids, if not for you. That's what's important. And then ask, how do you move towards that sort of life? Those are really the important discussions. It's not about getting mad. It's not about blaming people. It's about where do we end up?
Thank you.
So, I think we have to. I think what Sandy says is true in some ways, but I'm a little worried about this reference to the king. Firstly, because you know you can still have a system with a monarchy that's actually democratic. I mean, we know in Europe, in Holland, in a number of other countries, Sweden, maybe the UK in some ways, you can have a monarchical system that actually represents the rights of the people. So I think we have to be a little careful. And more profoundly on that, I think it's very important not, and the internet so far has been too American. It's been too bound up in the ideology of America, in the manias, both the good and bad in America. And I think all too often, particularly Americans, have collapsed the narrative of the internet with the narrative of America. And you know, this idea of fighting tyranny and creating power to the people and democratizing and rebelling against the king. The reality, the future of the internet, will the data revolution improve our lives? It will improve our lives if we globalize it, if we acknowledge that the so-called global internet today isn't really an American internet. And that, I think, accounts for a lot of the tensions between Germany and the US, between Europe and the US. That doesn't legitimize the Chinese or the Russians or the Iranians splitting off their internet from the rest of the world. But Sandy is absolutely right. For the internet to grow up, it has to become global. But the idea of a globalized network is a myth. It doesn't exist. For the internet, I think, to mature, it needs to reflect the structures of the nation state in the 21st century. So the idea, I think, of a globalized internet, whilst I wouldn't necessarily be against it, I think it's a very attractive thing in theory, in practice doesn't work. So we need to escape the American narrative of an international world. Sandy's mentioned the UN several times and Davos. But those institutions, maybe not so much Davos, but the UN are increasingly undermined. They don't have any power. They don't have any relevance in our age. What's interesting about the 21st century is it's not the end. Whilst on the one hand we have a global world, on the other hand it's a world of nation states, and increasingly powerful nation states, whether they're China or Russia or the US or the EU. So I think we have to acknowledge that and make the internet reflect that. Secondly, very briefly, we're at the very, in terms of this discussion, we're at the very, why this discussion is so important, we're at the very early stages of this. We talk about big data, we're still in a small data world. But the big data, maybe not of 50 voters, but still, you know, the next 5 billion, the next 3 or 4 billion people are about to come online. Cisco and Ericsson says by 2020 there'll be 50 billion intelligent devices. We're on the verge of virtual reality and the Internet of Things. So the world we're discussing, the world of big data, is about to become a reality. That's why these issues are so important. The issues of surveillance and of individual rights, of liberty, of making sure that the data revolution improves our life, not only in terms of quantified things of poverty and famine, which are obviously extremely important, but in terms of freedom, in terms of meaning, in terms of labor, in terms of the things I'm discussing. Because the next 20 or 30 years of our digital history are going to be absolutely critical. And unless we acknowledge these problems now, in 10, 15, 20 years, it will be too late.
Gentlemen, thank you so much for this great debate. That was absolutely illuminating, really fascinating to listen to both of you. Thank you. Thank you so much. We've identified 70% of agreement. We have certainly not resolved all the issues today, but that wasn't our goal. Thank you again. Thank you also to our audience for your contribution, for tweeting, for raising your hands, for discussing with us. Again, please give a round of applause to Sandy Pentland and Andrew Keen.
And now please join us for a reception and a glass of wine and some finger food outside.